Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Homage to the Blessed Noble and Perfectly Enlightened One. Namo sadanto sucedoye olahuri sanmyao sanputoshe. Wu shang shen shen wei miao fa bai qian wan jie nan zao yu wo jin jian wan de shou chi yuan jie ru lai zhen shi yi. The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful dharma in 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I bow to fathom the Thus Come One's true and actual meaning. Venerable Master and Dharma friends, welcome to our sutra lecture tonight. Good evening, everybody. Let's start by chanting the name of the sutra. It's here on our front cover. And Mr. Yap, could I give you this? I know you're all bundled in there. I have an extra. Maybe there's somebody who doesn't have one, so. So here we go. You can follow along with the Chinese characters if you can, or you can read the romanized sounds underneath. So na mo da fang, like that. Na mo da fang guang fu hua yan jing hua yan hai wei. O Pusa Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai. O Pusa Namo Da Fang Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai Hui. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai Wei O Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai Wei O Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yen Ji Hua Yen Hai Hui Po Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yen Ji Hua Yen Hai Hui Po Pu Sa. In your sutra text, if you would please turn to the last page. That would be 56 and 57. We'll start with the fourth line. The Chinese says, Fozi, disciples of the Buddha. Grab one, Pedro. It's yours. Okay, we ready? We're going to read the text first, and the way we do it is, because Chinese is new to many of us, I'll give you the sounds, and you read them back if you try it, if you'd like, care to. It's nice to hear those sounds coming out of your own speech apparatus, and how do the Chinese sounds taste in your mouth, in your ear. Then we'll go over to the English side on page 57 and read it together in unison, the way we used to do back in grade school. That's also fun, to hear your voice multiplied around the room by many voices. Okay, here we go. Fo zi pu sa yu chu di zhong yuan yi qie fo fa yuan qiu gu man zu pu ti fen fa. Continue. Di er di li xin gou gu. Okay. Over to the right, here we go. Ready with me together, disciples of the Buddha. While on the first ground, the Bodhisattva fulfills the Bodhi share dharmas by engaging with vows to seek the Buddha Dharma. While on the second ground, he does so by leaving mental defilements behind. Okay. All right. Good. We're going to take this in bite-sized pieces. We're on what's called the Ten Grounds. And this is a chapter in our sutra, which is called the Buddha's Flower Garland, the Huayanjing. And this chapter is one of the most important chapters in the whole sutra, because it tells a story that people who read all of, or who heard all of the Buddha's teaching, considered this the most complete story of a bodhisattva. Bodhisattva, Sanskrit word meaning us. The closest we have in the West is probably a saint. A saint. Saints is not too far away from what I grew up understanding a saint was. A saint was a person plus, someone who was the best kind of human. Saintly, someone who is better than human. So maybe better because we don't see much saintly behavior in the public sphere. And maybe it's just being a good person is what makes a saint. Is the Bodhisattva a saint? That's a question we could debate some other time. But this is the story of the Bodhisattva here in the Ten Grounds chapter. And we've been progressively going through it. We've reached now the seventh ground. And in this, we're almost, we're still in the first, inside the first half of the seventh ground. And this passage we're on, we started last week. I repeated last week's tonight. And you can see we've got on the second ground, third ground, fourth ground, fifth ground. This is a thumbnail sketch running through all seven that we've reached. And so I want to use this chance to go back and review what was on those grounds. Tell a story from the bigger story. Okay, so it's storytelling time at the Berkeley Monastery tonight. And each of the grounds indeed has many stories. Last week we talked about the fivefold fears and how the Bodhisattva is able to vanquish, how to overcome, how to conquer the fivefold fears in his or her own heart. So that's just one tiny teaspoon of gallons of Dharma in that first ground, but we picked out that story to tell. Tonight we're going to tell another story from the second ground, and this is certainly the beating heart of the second ground that we're going to share tonight. So let's take a look here. Says, disciples of the Buddha, while on the first ground, the Bodhisattva fulfills the Bodhi share dharmas. We'll come back to that. By engaging with vows, we'll come back to that, to seek the Buddha Dharma. Okay. So, as he or she begins this this step-by-step practice of the bodhisattva path, the bodhisattva fulfills the bodhi-share dharmas. Okay, Buddhist technical language. What's that about? That's the question that our two dialogue partners in the sutra are talking about. Now, a lot of the Buddha Dharma comes out as dialogue, two people talking. Plato, if you've read Plato, Socrates is having a dialogue with his students. He'll ask the student a question that he knows the answer to, and the student will come back with an answer, and Socrates will go, oh, that's very good, but did you ever think of this? What about that? That's not bad, but suppose you looked at it from this point of view. Does that change things? So it's a dialogue, right? So a lot of the sutras are the same way. If people have read the Diamond Sutra, the Vajra Sutra, it's the Buddha and who? Who's the dialogue partner in the Vajra Sutra? Subuddhi, Subuddhi, known as the general of the Dharma. Now, does Subuddhi not know the answers? Well, for the sake of the ongoing conversation, he needs to be taught. He needs to be led, or as the Latin verb educere, to pull out, to lead out. Educere goes to what? Education, right? So education is pulling out things that you kind of understood, but you didn't see them in the full light of day. And a skillful teacher pulls them out, and you go, oh, I never saw that before. That's great. Yeah, I learned something, right? So that's the value of these dialogues. This is a dialogue. And actually, in each of the chapters of the Avatamsaka, not each of them, many of the chapters of the Avatamsaka, it's a dialogue, conversation. And our dialogue partners in this chapter are two bodhisattvas. One of them is named Vajra Treasury, Treasury of Vajra. Vajra is a Sanskrit word, which means a substance that's like a diamond. It's hard, unbreakable. It's brilliant, sheds light. It can cuts through delusion, and it's permanent. So Treasury of Vajra, storehouse of this diamond-like, adamantine, indestructible, light-transmitting substance called Vajra. So he's the one who tells the story. He's essentially the keeper of the lore. He knows the stuff. And as we found out at the beginning of the chapter, he didn't want to share it. He didn't want to tell it because he was afraid nobody would get it. He was afraid people would doubt it, laugh at it, gossip about it, you know, slander it. And further, he said, you know, this is tough. It's hard. It's subtle. What's it like? He said, it's like the tracks a bird makes flying through the air. The bird goes by. Do you see the tracks? No. But you know he did. And then some clever fellow photographs it at 60 FPS, feet per second, and here's the bird going. Indeed, the bird made a track, but our eye couldn't follow it. So Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva said, yeah, that's what's going to happen. You know, I'm afraid that's going to happen. So I won't talk about it. Well, our second dialogue partner, whose name is Chietoye Pusa, Liberation, Liberated Moon, Moon of Liberation, Moon like Lunar Liberation, all the different ways you could translate that. He doesn't give up. He says, come on, come on. You got to tell us the stuff. We're all able to follow. Don't doubt it, please, Venerable Sir. You know, we got to, you got to tell us. You got to let us know about the 10 grounds. We want to hear it. We're mature bodhisattvas who need this the way thirsty people need water, he said. So Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva said, essentially. He said, nah, I don't think so. Nah, I'm afraid it's not going to work. The Buddha comes in. And notice the Buddha's not the one telling the story. It's not from his mouth, although his he kind of blesses the bodhisattva to teach it. The Buddha says, it's okay, you can actually go ahead. That's all right. So, Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva doesn't dare say to the Buddha, no, he doesn't. No, I don't think so. Okay, all right, I'll tell it. So, the conversation began. So, seven grounds, seven chapters of the bigger story later, we're here. Here's where we are. Okay, that's kind of our setup. And each of these grounds is in itself a complete unit with a topic, a development, a refrain that repeats throughout, you know, so it's goes along like that. And here, in our section here, we've got a little thumbnail sketch of an answer to a question that Moon of Liberation. Okay, we didn't quite hear. I've got a sound I want to point to later. Moon of Liberation, Bodhisattva, asks, he says, there's this dharma called the Putifanva, the Bodhi share dharmas. He asks it up on the top of page 56 and 57 if you want to check it out there. He says, this particular dharma is really key. This is a list of practices. This is really important. And what I want to know is, do these all come to fullness? Do they all get practiced right on the seventh ground? Or can a bodhisattva actually practice them on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7? That's his question. Because he wants to know. He's obviously tuning in on these particular practice methods, and he wants to master them. Good student, right? And so Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva is now answering that question. Okay? That's where we are. If I were Doug Powers, I would say, is everybody, that's Doug Powers' shorthand for it, does everybody understand what I have said so far? But he goes, everybody, and you're supposed to go, yeah. So, everybody follow? So, okay, last week, what did he say? The answer to the short answer to the question before he elaborates was, on the seventh ground, you get them all right. And the key to them is what we introduced that 2 weeks ago and pointed to last week, called effortless practice. Effortless practice. And it's, you do them without having the concept cross your brain that you then talk about, think about, reflect on, question, etc. They happen as if they were hardwired. As if, well, not as if, they happen because they're already innate. These practices are, as you could say, hardwired as breathing. We don't have to think to breathe, right? It's a different part of the brain that actually governs our respiration. As soon as we come out of mother's womb, we're and life begins, independent of the life that we had for 9 months. So they're like that. They're just as automatic in us as the sleep rhythms. You don't have to think about going to sleep. When you're sleepy, you sleep. Sleep sleeps you, right? So that's what that was his answer. And he said, from 1 to 6 of the grounds, you have to practice at it. You get better at it. When you get to 7, it flips to automatic pilot. Okay? That's interesting, right? Now, not by itself. This happens with effort and practice over time. So if somebody's thinking, well, this is the first I've heard of this, how could this apply to me? Well, yeah, but when you went to, what grade do you learn arithmetic? Where do you learn your times tables? Third? Third grade is math? Or that too late? Second grade. Okay, 2 plus 2 is 4, right? That's second grade curriculum. When you're in kindergarten, you're still going 2, 2, right? Ni, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You're still learning the numbers. You haven't learned to do numbers times numbers, you know? So it's not that they didn't exist, it's that you didn't hear about them yet. So we've got them, but we have to hear about them, and very important, see them done. Nothing teaches like an example. So we have to see them done. Okay. All right. So that's the overview. Let's dig in. What does he say? The bodhisattva fulfills that list of dharmas called bodhi-share dharmas by what? Engaging in vows. Page 57 there, Kevin? 57. The last page. Just turn to the back. You got it. By engaging with vows to seek the Buddha Dharma. On that first ground, one of the most important things that a bodhisattva does is what? Sees suffering clearly. Sees people in pain and says, I'm going to do something about it. You got a songbook there, Kevin. You need a sutra. You'll need the last page of the songbook, but not yet. Wait till the end of the lecture. We're going to print up some more of these sutra texts for sure. So, the bodhisattva on that first ground is now awake to what? He's awake, you could say, to a bigger nervous system than he had before. Once the bodhisattva gets to that first ground, he connects with others. And their pain is his pain. I live part of the year in a forest, and my building is about 20 feet up because it's on a hillside, so we're built. And the trees, we're half 20 feet up the trees, and so we see the birds. And there's a period of every new baby bird's life where the mother or the father, if it's a kookaburra, it's the father, that father is wired into the kid's hunger. And the baby bird just and they have a special feed me sound, and it's accompanied by those gaping mouths that you see, you know, robins, you see in the baby in the nest, and these three mouths like that, and the mom goes out and grabs some food and stiffs it in the mouth. For a period, while that baby bird is in the nest and in charge of the adult, it's as if the adult has added a nervous system. The child's motivates that parent adult bird into action that is not part of his life before that blessed event happened and came out of the egg, right? Nice bird, you know, with its mate out there in the trees, eating, sleeping. Comes the kid, and suddenly it's like, whoa, I'm motivated to go grab food and put it in that gaping mouth. So it's as if the parent bird adds on to its nervous system. The child's concern is the parent's concern, to the point where the parent will do unusual things that he would never, she would never consider doing any other time, like approaching a human being repeatedly asking for more food, adding the local monk into the food chain, right? So, okay, more, he's still hungry, I can't smoke more, you know. So, yeah. And then the baby flies away and grows up, is no longer a baby, and the adult goes back to, you know, not so much business to do. So the bodhisattva at that first ground is tuned in, now aware of others' suffering in a whole new way. And there's a process in that first ground, if you remember, those of you who were here, where the bodhisattva says things like, I've got to get involved to end their suffering. And I understand that to get to the root of the suffering, I have to understand the Buddha Dharma. That's one of the big moments in that first ground, is the connection that to get to the actual cause of the pain of living beings, of which the Bodhisattva is now aware of his deeper connection, to get to the core of that, you've got to get to a spiritual cause. And the Buddha knows how. The Buddha knows the way to get to that spiritual cause and has a method. The Bodhisattva says, I'm going to learn it. I'm going to learn it. That's the first ground. So what engages with vows to seek the Buddha Dharma? The motive for all the rest of the grounds arises in that first ground, which is end pain. Two words, end pain for others. Because this Bodhisattva knows how. Knows how. I think it must be like a doctor. A good doctor. Right? When I was a graduate student, at one point I had, I guess it was, what do you call it? A midlife crisis, only I wasn't, I had a mid-graduate life crisis, which was, I don't think I want to study Chinese anymore. I think I want to be a doctor, you know. And all the people around me went, oof, let's hope he outgrows that one in a hurry, you know. So what did I do? In the middle of my MA program, I took pre-med. I started in pre-med. It was a disaster. I didn't know how to do a slide rule, even. Before calculators. Slide rules. Remember slide rules? Anybody? You're all too young. Who remembers a slide rule? Two hands in the back. Two hands. Two older guys, right? Slide rules. What do they call them in Chinese? What was the slide? I don't know. We Jiao shuma? Gai, that's Cantonese. What is Mandarin? I don't know. Okay, it's called an I don't know. There we go. Gai so set? Gai so set. Okay, in Cantonese. Ji suan ji, bu shi ji suan ji. Ji suan ji shi dian dong de. Yeah, it's a calculator. Kevin, try again. What is it called? Abacus. Suan pan. No, it's not a suan pan. Suan pan, bu shi suan pan. Ji suan, ji suan shi, ruler, ji suan shi, ji suan shi. Thank you, Kevin. We got a translation. Ah, yeah, now around the room. Ji suan shi. Okay, it looked like a ruler, and it had this, and it had the middle section of it could move off a scale, and then it had a bar that you could, with a needle that you could, you know. Okay, I was surrounded in the lecture hall with 400 other hotshot pre-med students who were the smartest Chinese, Indian, Japanese kids on campus who were going with their slide rules. And I was going, this, it goes like that, and it goes like that, you know. These are kids who had, they were science majors from every top high school in the world. By the way, did you all notice that UC Berkeley, again, is the number one public university 19 straight years, according to U.S. News? That's okay. That's all right. All you Stanford grads, it's all right. We don't really care all that much about it. So there they were, and they were like way ahead. They had already had biology, physiology, math, and science. I was a Chinese major, right? Okay, so it's like, oh, geez. I didn't last the semester. I bombed out. But the one good thing that I did do was I said to myself, if I'm going to be a doctor, what if I can't stand the sight of blood? I better find out now before I launch into a medical career. Okay, so I went to Highland Hospital and volunteered in the emergency room. And the ER, Highland's ER, is our county trauma center, right? That's where the gunshots go. That's where the big accidents go. So I went over and volunteered, and sure enough, I could stand the sight of blood, and I was moved by the suffering. Because it happens fast in the ER. The ambulance rolls in, and their people's lives are determined in 60 seconds, 120 seconds, you know, 3 minutes, life or death. And one of the best things that happened was I got to take a really good look at doctors. And I was surprised because, first of all, to become a doctor is the bodhisattva path. I mean, the training that you undergo in order to save lives and end suffering puts you in a category that your license plate deserves to have that little tag that, you know, you can go in through the gate when everybody else is lined up because you're a doctor. You're a lifesaver. So that's, I give my utmost respect to people who successfully go through that training. But the big surprise for me was discovering that in the ER, if there were 10 doctors, men and women, from every nationality, every walk of life, of those 10 MDs, medical doctors, probably there were two who I thought had the gift of healing. What about the other 8? Roughly speaking, and mind you, I am not qualified to have an opinion, but based on my observation, of those remaining 8, there were probably 2 who, in my estimation, had come into medicine for other reasons, right? Who were there because their dads were doctors, and that was what you did in that family. You were going to be a doctor from the time you were a boy or girl coming out in that family. And the heart was not there. Shin butsai yet, right? And there were probably about 6 who I thought were survivors who had made it through med school, made it through intern, made it through residency, made it through, and who were, you know, going to save lives. But seemed maybe mechanics. You know, a lot of medicine is the physical stuff, moving, you know. I have a heart surgeon friend in Los Angeles who tells stories about the patient overheating, and so he pulls the heart out and dumps it in a bucket of ice, all connected with the tubes, you know. Cool it down, throws it in the bucket with ice, you know, and then later when it's cooled down, puts it back in, you know, mechanical stuff. It's like, I've actually seen that happen. It's a shocker to see how mechanical through the bones, you know. But then there were those 2 who, as soon as they walked in the room, you felt better. It, before they touched you, before they checked you out, diagnosed you, there was something about their presence that put you together better than you were before. And those are the bodhisattva types, I think. You know, this is rough. But you just, as soon as their presence came into the room, there was something healing, wholesome, and proper about their presence. And you felt better, you know. 2 out of 10, I think, 1 out of 5 probably had that gift of the men and women I met in Highland Hospital, ER. So, to conclude that story, I came back to Gold Mountain, and I had decided at that point that I was going to move into the monastery. I was still a, you know, 95% a graduate student at Berkeley, and 5% I'd already taken refuge with Master Hua. And so I went in. We're hearing an interesting feedback noise there. I went in and said to Sherfu, I had pretty much decided that I was never going to be a science student, and you need to be. You need to have that foundation. So I went in and I said, Sherfu, I think I want to be a doctor. Is that a good idea? And Master Hua, as he often did, said, Kui. You give him a good idea, and he'll, Kui, you know. And he said, but before you do that, he said, why don't you write your 志愿书? write out your statement of intent. Where are your vows? He said, I'd like to read it. Write it out. That'll help. Oh, really good. Here's the Chan master giving me an assignment, you know. So I thought it over. What was I really after? And the notion about leaving home and becoming a monk hadn't fully emerged. Right? So he said, you write it out and bring it in, and then you read it to me. Oh, boy, okay. So I came back. I said, sure. Can I read it to you? He said, koi. So I read it in my broken Chinese, right, trying to make sense of it. And Shrif was kind of, you know, listening and giving this mixed up kid, you know, all of his attention. And so then he said, that would be really good if you could be a doctor. I wanted to be a doctor, said Master Hua. He said, I memorized 11 medical books. And then he started to recite. He started to recite the Yao Xing Fu, the treatise on the nature of medicine in verse form, which is a list of all the available materia medica, all the natural herbs and healing things from the mineral world, the vegetable world, and the animal world. I'm like, Shriv was reciting 5 minutes. He just went on and on and on like that. And he said, yeah. And he stopped, and I'm, you know, kind of catching my breath. Because here's, you ever heard anybody recite at length? Like a poem, we hear a poem, and we're like impressed, right? And Shrifu was going on. Do we know what that is? That's interesting sound. You heard that, right, Jerry? Yeah, everybody did. Okay. Is that it? Are there any doctors in the hall who are being told to get... Okay. That's it, huh? Okay. I didn't get it. Okay. So, he said, yeah, I memorized 11 medical texts. He said, but then I decided I didn't want to be a doctor. He said, I thought saving people was really good. That's a good thing to do with your life. He said, but what if I, in the process of saving someone, killed them? Diagnosed it wrong. What if because of my mistake they died? I don't think I could ever forgive myself. And he waited, you know, and he watched me digest this, and I'm big gears are turning, you know. And then he said, but you know, he said, even the best of doctors, when the time comes, has to lie down and die. He said, no doctor cures the biggest disease. He paused again, and I'm like, you know, rich, ding, 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 ding. And what would that be, Shrivu? Birth and death, he said. No doctor cures that one. We all lie down and die when the time comes. And he kind of turns to go, and I'm like, but Shrivu, what should I do? And he turns back and he says, you could be a Dharma doctor. Boom. Big rock in the ponds, ripples going out, right? He says, yeah, if you could be a Dharma doctor, you could end the biggest disease, birth and death. So that's what I did, he said, and he turned and walked away. So it's like, okay. And I went back to studying Chinese. That was pretty much the end of my medical career. Maybe in this life. He told me later that I had been a doctor in many lifetimes. Whatever. What? Okay. So, the Bodhisattva on the first ground says, I'm going to engage in practices I'm going to make vows to seek the Buddha Dharma because I know who I want to cure of their disease of ignorance, he said. So that's it. He engages with vows to seek the Buddha Dharma. That's the first ground. Okay, that's where we were last week. Now, number two, what is our snip? What is our thumbnail sketch of the second ground? Ready? Here we go. While on the second ground, he fulfills the Bodhisattva Dharmas by leaving mental defilements behind. So each of these seven, we're only on seven because this is number seven, right? He says, I'm going to fulfill the Bodhisattva Dharmas. Bodhisattvas do that while on the second ground by Li Go. That's the name of the second ground, Li Go Di, the second stage, the second status. The 10 status chapter. Doesn't sound right. The 10 grounds chapter. Okay, leaving mental defilements behind. All right, mental defilements. You have a defiled mind? Oh, yeah. I know what that would be, right? A dirty mind? Yeah, but it's not. We say dirty, dirty old man, dirty mind. That's like thinking improper thoughts, right? Thinking defiled thoughts. Well, yeah, but it's not only like promiscuity or rage or jealousy, those kind of defilements. It's thoughts that are wrong because they do not contribute to samadhi and wisdom. That's the new standard for a bodhisattva. He or she is interested in now purity, or you could say the new word, people who read Carlos Castaneda, remember the Don Juan books? Who remembers the Don Juan book? Same hands are going to go up. Oh, a couple more? Good, yeah. Same one, yeah. See, all my references come from a certain age. All the young people are going, hopeless, just hopeless, this guy. You know? Harry Potter. Harry Potter. Yeah. You're hopeless. Harry Potter is just totally... What's the new one? The Twilight? Twilight? That's already 10 years old. Which one is it? Lord of the Rings? Nah, sorry. Okay, a couple hands. No, you're 40, and that's already like, nah. There's got to be, what is it now? It's probably something closer to Grand Theft Auto 5 or 6, you know, something like that. Percy Jackson is already dated. There's three Percy Jackson films out already. I mean, that's not new. What's new? Anybody? Sorry, we don't read anymore. We don't do books, right? That's the answer. Maybe our generation, or you know, is like books. So the bodhisattva here is interested in finding the thoughts that lead to immaculate. Was that the word? The Don Juan, Carlos Castaneda, right? Immaculate. No, not pristine. Yeah, immaculate. Warrior. Right? The Don Juan books, not Don Juan the Lothario, the great lover. Don Juan the Yaqui Brujo, the medicine man of the northern Mexico Indian tribes. And his student, Carlos. Now, there's all kinds of questions. Was it all fabricated? Did Don Juan ever exist at all? Big controversy in the literary world. But the books stand as a testimony. They excited so many people because in those books, Carlos, who was the student, the kind of the hapless young man who stumbled upon the way of the shaman, according to the Yaqui, the Yaqui Indian style, he was being led towards becoming an immaculate warrior. Somebody who didn't make the slightest mistake in his witchcraft, in his shaman spells, in his mantra life. Okay? So, interesting. Okay. So, the bodhisattva, that's immaculate, might be a better translation than purity in our, you know, in our talk about precepts. So, just posing that one over there. So, the bodhisattva is interested in being immaculate, being completely still, and watching wisdom arise. Why? So he can use it to follow the vows that he made in the first ground. If he is immaculate, if he is absolutely still and wise, he, she has a better chance of getting people past their pain. So this is what relationships and practical. Anybody who thinks Buddha Dharma is airy-fairy philosophy and somehow lonely and like out on the mountain cave by yourself, maybe for a while, but it's deeply intertwined with other beings' pain, and it's how to help. It's down on the ground, as this is explained, right? So if we always come back to that, those fundamental principles, we'll get this right, which is what? Bodhisattva is past himself, has, leading up to the first ground, has been working on his me in the middle, me alone, that sense of I'm an autonomous unit, independent from everyone else. Right? Self-made man. Uh-uh. Self-made woman. Uh-uh. Mom was there when you were born. You're not self-made. You're other-made. Okay, that's a foundational idea. Relationships. That's how the Buddha Dharma arises in this story. Now, there are other Buddha stories where the goal is not spoken this way. Okay? Same awareness, different way of telling the story. Here, it's based on relationships, and it's based on getting past that lonely self into relationship and aware of others' pain. I see, I feel, I have this extended nervous system. I know when you're in pain. I can see it. I see affliction. Boy, oh boy. You just, you know where I see a lot of affliction? In the mall. I'm not a great mall person. No, I don't think there are any mall monks, right? The great mall monk, you know. I go into a mall and I'm out of there in 4 minutes. Because the need in there, full of affliction. Now, sure, if you're buying gifts for someone, it's joy. The joy in the giving of the gift, but the sense of taking all of your resources that you sweat for and exchanging it for stuff in the mall, and all of the promises that when you buy this thing, you'll be happy. You know, it's the let's get out of the mall. Let's take it just to the promise of the marketplace. Nowhere better summed up than former tobacco ads. Notice the tobacco ads are not in front of us as much, right? When is the last time you saw Salem takes you away? Right? What was it? A boy and a girl on a beach, you know, at sunset, brilliant sunset in a beach. The two of them are walking hand in hand, and this hand has a cigarette. Right? Salem takes you away. The promise is, buy the cigarette, you get the girl and the beach. You get the guy and the beach and the joy and the glossy picture, right? Youth, wishes fulfilled, eternal happiness. You can see I don't know how to smoke. I don't do it right. Right? You have to do it with, you know, I don't know, Humphrey Bogart. So. That's a lie. That's just not true. They're not related. The cigarette and the sunset, don't have any necessary relationship until you see the picture, and then you go, ah, click, yep, I want that. Cigarettes, please. Where is it? Where is the joy? You know. That's dukkha in the making. That's the first step. That's actually the second noble truth, which is where suffering comes from, is desire. And when you reach for the cigarette or whatever it might be, toothpaste, they used to do the same with toothpaste ads, you know. You know, because of the toothpaste, and then everything follows, that Hollywood smile. And so that's not true. There's no immediate relationship between acquiring the thing and the story that the picture tells you. Okay, that's dukkha. That's suffering. Bodhisattva goes, oh, man, back to sleep. We're going back to sleep. So, yeah. Anyway, he, she sees the suffering and goes, how do I wake him up? Because why? It hurts when you get the thing and it doesn't deliver. It's not what it promised. But we go for it over and over and over. We build, Americans in particular, are so good at the storytelling promise. We are the best marketers. We invented it. Marketing. That's one of the great moments in the Century of the Self, that documentary that we like so much. Anybody who doesn't know about that, and anybody online who wants to, if I had a chat room, I would put the link right there. So, which is what? It's a BBC documentary called The Century of the Self. And it talks about how in the 20th century, the nephew of Sigmund Freud, particularly Edward Bernays, invented public relations, invented advertising. And it's wonderfully done. Before this phenomena, this American phenomena of telling the story of the promise of joy at the acquisition of the thing, before, let's say we're buying shoes. Okay, we want shoes. And what was the experience of buying shoes? You go into town where there is a cobbler. Cobbler. Right? Remember that word? Anybody ever use that word ever in your life? A cobbler? What's that? Apple cobbler. No. You eat apple cobbler. You don't eat the cobbler that I'm talking about. The cobbler I'm talking about is a shoemaker. And every community needed one. Yeah, if your apple cobbler tastes like shoes, you're doing it wrong, right? So you need a shoemaker. Because why? Who goes barefoot? When you're out on a country road, you better not. Work in the fields, you better get sturdy shoes, right? Who makes them? Cobbler. You need a shoemaker. How do you find him? You go into town and you look in front of the store and there's a boot hanging over the door. A boot, usually just the outline, right? You look at the boot, oh, cobbler. You go inside and what do you say? I need my shoes resoled. Because I worn through. There's a hole in the bottom of my shoe. The cobbler goes, oh, okay, do you want this one or this one? And now he takes him and he says, how long? He says, 3 days. And you pay him and he comes back. And the cobbler's in there. Right? Making your shoes. Resoling the shoes that you've had probably for 2, 3, 4, 5 years. Styles don't change. You want a shoe to protect your foot. Right? That's it. And maybe you got a work boot and maybe you got a Sunday go to church pair of shoes. That's it. No such thing as running shoes. No such thing as Air Jordans. No such thing as sandals. Who wears sandals? Poets, beatniks wear sandals, right? In Greenwich Village. Not a working man, woman. You want sturdy shoes. Okay, that was shoes. Okay, Edward Bernays comes along. And he goes, ah, hey, cobbler, You want to sell a lot of shoes? He says, let's do it. What do? He makes beautiful pictures of people that you admire wearing wingtips. You know, the leather shoes, little holes in the toes, wingtips? He makes women's shoes high-heeled. Oh, high-heeled shoes, look at those. And he shows, you know, beautiful young models wearing high-heeled shoes. And women are going, what would I look like in those, right? And then he makes a pair of high-heeled shoes in red. And he makes a pair in white. And he shows a bride wearing her pumps, you know, under her wedding gown. And everybody going, shoes. So what does the cobbler do? He goes out, he pulls down the boot from in front of his store, and he puts glass in the front, and he puts out a rack with five or six different colors, styles, shapes, leather, you know, materials of shoes. And you go by and you, I want those. You go in, say, oh, that's nice. Well, try them on. Oh, I don't have your size. Can I order them from New York? It'll be about a week. Montgomery Ward's will deliver them from the Montgomery Ward's catalog, the kind of shoe, you know. And, oh my, suddenly what? An industry is born based on, I not only want those, I need those. And in the mind, a mental defilement arises, which is, I'm not happy until I acquire that. That's called what? Desire, greed. Greed, maybe you didn't know you needed it until you saw it. And now, oh my goodness, Imelda Marcos, right? You all know about Imelda Marcos? She's the wife of one of the former presidents of the Philippines. Had how many pairs? 500? 500 pairs of shoes? And only 2 feet. You know, wear, get bigger ones, you can put three on at once? No. She has a shoe for every false thought, a different pair, you know. Oh my God. So suddenly, advertising is born. Wonderful film. We'll go away from the sutra if I go further into that. But this wonderful documentary called The Century of the Self, go home tonight, download it. It's on YouTube. It's free for distribution. It's been released to the public domain. Creative Commons. And it tells the story of how advertising created greed. You didn't know you needed it until Edward Bernays inspired advertising and public relations. And he messed with our minds. He messed with our minds. Take you back to the boot over the cobbler's shop, right? What was it before? Oh, I need my shoes repaired because my toes are sticking out through the uppers. So the cobbler puts them back, you wear your shoes. Your shoes. The shoes you wear. The only shoes you wear. 20 years later, wow, you go into your closet and you've got a bunch of shoes. You didn't know you needed. Because why? You didn't, really. But once the mind gets defiled, right? Not what does defilement mean here? It means you've had a thought that now connects with your heart that changes your behavior. So you go out, you acquire shoes, and suppose somebody else shows up at the ball with the same shoes you have on. You're unhappy because your shoes don't shine anymore. And you don't like her, and she's wearing your shoes. Oh, more unhappiness. So, my goodness, fascinating documentary about how that happened. That's mental defilement. Okay, so you understand, bodhisattva is clear on this process, is watching his or her mind and says, yeah, I saw that thought rise, and number one, cigarettes don't put me on that beach. They don't help me. In fact, cigarettes, another whole story. We don't see those ads anymore, right? Not so much. They used to, you go into San Francisco on 101, on the cross 80 across the bridge, there used to be doop, 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 all those billboards. You know, Salem, Viceroy, Tarryton, Marlborough, Lucky's, Camel's, Winston. All the names of British royalty, interestingly enough, right? Marlborough, Winston, Tarryton. So we don't see those now because we recognize that cigarettes actually harm you. So those advertisements, we just, gone. We don't tell that story anymore. Where did it go back in? Gone? You know. How funny we are that we'll tell ourselves those stories until we hear another story. And then that's truth. Where's the truth? Bodhisattva asks that question with every thought. Is that true? That I need that or I'm not happy? What about if I get it and I'm still not happy? Where's the truth? That's the question a meditator asks himself or herself. Watching what? Watching the billboard of your mind. The billboard of his mind. Get to the truth. What's real? Is that really true? So that could be actually a good huatou in meditation. True? Chandama, you know. Honto desu ka? Really? Is that right? Challenge those thoughts. Don't accept them as absolutely the case every time. So, what I thought would be a really good snapshot of the second ground is a section of the second ground that has become one of my very, very, very favorite lists out of the Avatamsaka Sutra. It's part of the second ground. Like last week, we had the fivefold fears. In the second ground, the Bodhisattva looks at the 10 evil deeds and their retributions. Okay, stay with me. The 10, it's not scary. It's helpful. So, in the second ground, it talks about what? Mental defilements. Ways the mind can think that hurt us and the world around us. Okay, Shishan Shi'e, it's called in Chinese. And in this list, my favorite list out of that second ground, it talks about 10 particular thoughts and their antidotes. 10 evil thoughts in my mind that rise, and what happens if I don't turn them. Each thought has two results. Actually, it's three, but the first one is a refrain, and then there are two, it's the general, and there's two specific things that happen. So here's how it goes. It says, I'll just put my palms together and read you the first one. Disciples of the Buddha, this bodhisattva, mahasattva, makes the following reflection. The offense of killing can lead beings to fall among the hells, hungry ghosts, and animals. If they are reborn among people, they will have two kinds of retribution. One, a short lifespan. Two, many illnesses. Okay? That's the first one. And what are the 10? Three with the body, four with the mouth, and three with the mind. They're called offenses. 10 evil deeds that arise from thoughts. And when you turn them, when you catch them and turn them, because why? Because you were watching. You were watching the billboard of your mind as you roll down the freeway of your life. You catch them and you turn them. What are they? Just do the list. Killing, stealing, and lust. Three things we do with the body that hurt us and hurt others. Four with the mouth. Lying. What's called double tongue, which is gossip, slander, backbiting. Harsh speech, profanity. And frivolous speech, or just prattle. Four with the mouth. Three with the mind. Greed, anger, and what's called wrong views. or sometimes delusion. So, killing, stealing, lust with the body, Buddha said, hurt you and others. Hurt yourself when you do them. Four with the mouth, out lying, double-tongued speech, splitting people up with your words, or slander, gossip. The third one is harsh speech or profanity, four-letter words. The fourth is frivolous speech, prattle, considered an evil deed. And then greed, anger, delusion. Okay? That's the list. That's the 10. And here, in the section that's the second ground, the Bodhisattva is going through the results if you take those out into the world. If you miss them in the mind and they motivate you into action with body, mouth, and mind. That's why this is such a neat section, because it's chunky. Capsules. Boom. Okay, what does he say? He says, and this first part is a refrain. It repeats all 10 times. This is the Buddha's words, okay? Not me saying this, the Buddha's words. The offense of killing, if I kill, and it's serious enough, I can lose my human body at death. I can stop being a human. If the killing that I do is serious enough, I can fall into, it says, become a hell being, a ghost, or an animal as a result. That's a possibility. So that can happen. You can lose your status as a human. Okay, not every time. If you're reborn among humans, you come back and you're a human, but what happens? The residual effect of having taken the life from another creature impacts you. You get the result of having driven the life force, the spirit, out of a body of a living creature. Because we're connected, that's the subtext of this, because it doesn't happen independent of cause and effect, I, the person who killed, gets a result, which is what? A short life. My lifespan is diminished. Or, I'm a human being, but I'm sick a lot. Isn't that interesting? What is it? Cause, effect. In stark, clear, brief nuggets. Okay? How does it go in Chinese? It goes, yi duan ming, er duo bing. Really short, right? Short life, much illness. Now, the Buddha is not saying, I'm going to make this happen. The Buddha is saying, here's what I see. Here's how the universe is built. This is the piston, the crankshaft, the tappets, the valves operating in the engine of our lives. Here's how it works, says the Buddha, says actually Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva. Okay, that sounds scary, so walk it back. When I die young, is it because I killed? Well, the Buddha says, can happen. If I'm sick a lot, if my health is always not robust, is it because I, at some time, this not just this body only, but my essential spirit, where the karma accumulates, did I kill a lot? Did I, because of my hands or my agency, with weapons, with butcher knives, did I take the life of other beings? If so, in this life where I've now come into a body, the result of that is with me, and I'm not fully healthy. I'm not operating at full capacity. All right, that's a lot to swallow, right? Now, what I find helpful is flip it around. Restate it positively, and it works. Now, this is not the sutra. This is my interpretation of it. Okay, the blessing of bestowing life or you could say the blessing of nurturing others' lives, can lead living beings into life in the wholesome destinies, make you a human, an asura, or a deva. If you come back as a human, you will have these two blessings, long life, robust health. Okay, I like that. That sounds better. So what would that mean in real life terms? Suppose we wanted to live a long time and be healthy. Then take it back to the cause, if that's the result, and nurture life. Find ways to enhance other beings' well-being. Right? Give them food. Feed them. Don't harm them. Find things that oppress them and remove those things. Right? Solve other people's problems for them, particularly around their life force. And the result is the same. The ripples go out. Because we're connected, that's the subtext. We live a long time and we're healthy. That is like, oh yeah. I can make that connection in my mind, and I don't need psychic power. That makes sense to me. Okay. So, what does the text say? The offense of killing can lead living beings to fall among the hells, ghosts, and animals. If they're reborn among people, they will have two kinds of retribution. One, short lifespan. Two, much illness. Where's the mental defilement that on the second ground the bodhisattva fulfills the Bodhisattva dharmas by leaving mental defilements? It's in the thought of whatever led to killing behavior, which would be things like anger, hatred. Drop dead, you rotten so-and-so. Oh, I don't know, but maybe those Second Amendment guys will have an answer to that. Or the most recent one, which was, oh yeah, well, get rid of her bodyguards with guns and see what happens. Okay. Not very vague, hinting at drop dead. You know, threats to the opponent. So yeah, when those thoughts rise up and I don't catch them, they can lead to, if you have an opportunity, you have the shafa, shayan. Sha yin sha yan sha fa sha ye in the bhikshu precepts. When did you kill? When was the offense done? When you had the cause of killing, the conditions of killing, the method of killing, some weapon arose, and you actually did it, then you've killed, says our monk's code. So, okay, yeah, what if you find ways to give life when something was about to die? You were one of those strange people who picked up the worms that get washed. We don't have rain in California. When was the last time you saw rain in California? Used to be when it rained. Remember rain? You remember waterfalls from the sky? 6 years of drought. So when it rained, we used to see the worms get washed up on, you know, certain times. You pick them up and put them in the grass. And the birds are going, hey! You create the conditions for a worm to not dry out on the sidewalk or get swallowed down the gullet of a poor starving bird who you deprived of a meal, right? Ooh, complicated. So, yeah, you find a way to extend the lifespan. You share food, the right kind of food. You tell the truth about food, so that people eat food that helps them. It doesn't hurt them. Not all food is equal. Right? So, interesting. That's the second ground. This is just a drop. It's a teaspoon out of the second ground, the ocean of the second ground. Talking about mental defilements. Trace the act of killing back, and it's a thought of hatred, anger. Okay. You want to hear another one? These are so good. I know I've told this story before, but this is a really personal one. Each of these are so good. The offense of loose speech, qi yu, the fourth kind of mouth karma, speech karma. The offense of loose speech can lead living beings to fall among the hells, hungry ghosts, and animals. If they're reborn among people, they will have two kinds of retribution. One, people will not accept what they say. Two, their speech will not be clearly understood. Okay? How's it go? It's called loose speech, frivolous speech sometimes. And roughly it's prattle, just talking, 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 like that. Or two, words that are meant to kind of fog the mind. Dirty jokes, or like things that are not entirely true because they're meant to make you laugh. I always thought about Don Rickles' humor. You know Don Rickles? He was an insult comedian, bless his heart. Not only Don Rickles was also, they say, a nice guy, but one his persona on stage was he would insult people. And you kind of went, because it hurt. You know, he would make fun of people. That was one of his acts. You know. So I was bowing on a pilgrimage, and every night reading the Avatamsaka Sutra along with my companion, Professor Verhoeven. And we got to this section of the second ground, and I'd never read it before. And I remember we were in Marin County when this happened, and bowing along, and got to that point, and I had this bong awareness, just like looking in a mirror at my face. The words of the sutra just hit me with the force of a baseball bat across the head. Boom! Which is what? I, at that point, had been silent for 2 years. I hadn't spoken for 2 years at that point. Not a word of speech, or conversation. And what I saw was an old habit. It's as if I played a tape of my life before I left home and started to pay attention to my words I spoke, which was what? I grew up not being able to fight very well. I wasn't any good with my fists. I wasn't a good fighter. And every kid wants to be strong and be, you know, tough, or, you know, not a pushover, not a wimp. So I would fight with my words. I got really good with my words. And one of the ways that I spoke was I would disarm people by getting them to like me by making them laugh. As long as I could get people to like me by laughing, they were less likely to punch me, right? Or to fight with me. They would be my buddy. So it was important for me to get people to laugh. And I was really good at telling funny stories or making stuff up, doing impersonations and things, so that people would laugh. The problem was, I paid no attention to whether the words I said were true or not. As long as I could get a laugh, that was the motive. Deeper than that, it's called ming yu, desire for fame or popularity. I wanted to be popular because you didn't beat up a popular guy as much, right? That was my rationale. But the truth is sacrificed in the storytelling. So if you say it in a put a positive spin on it, the stories get a lot of vinegar and salt added to them, salt and pepper. Taste better, funnier story. True or not? Well, not important. So this is what arose as it was a rainy February night, sitting in the back of a Plymouth on Highway 1 near Stinson Beach. What I saw was that
since I became, I guess, in high school and on through college, I had been encountering the situation that I didn't really acknowledge. And the situation was what? It was, I wanted people to accept my words when it counted. When you're living alone, you're no longer in your parents' home, you stand on your integrity, on what you say. Right? People, do they take you for your word? What I saw sitting there with the face-to-face with the mirror of the second ground was I had always, since I became independent of my parents, I had been in the habit of saying, no, no, that's not what I meant. And I noticed, as I was sitting there reading this, I had this little movie in my mind of being with buddies, right? Being with your friends, your classmates, your peers. And I would say something, and people would go, like that. They'd go, shake it off. Nope. When I said stuff, people never went, oh, okay, we'll do it that way. Never. Why? I was in the habit of speaking frivolously. What does it say? Two kinds of retribution. People will not accept what they say, and two, their speech will not be clearly understood. Those two things just hit me with this force, because why? I had been in the habit of saying, no, no, that's not what I meant. You didn't understand me. I was always trying to justify what I said, because people were in the habit of going, ha, 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 at the things I said, because that's what I wanted, until I didn't want that anymore. I wanted to be known for having a good idea. Or when I said something, people would go, they would dismiss it immediately, no matter whether it was a good idea or not, because I was in the habit of speaking frivolously. What they expected from me was a joke. So nobody had to take me seriously. Boom. Big awareness. And I thought, the sutra's telling my story. That's affliction. That's pain. If you want, now you're grown up a little bit and you want your words to count. My words didn't count because they knew anything that came out of my mouth was going to be ha 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 ha. Right? So, whoa. Flip it over. Okay, the offense of what? Sincere speech, the blessing of sincere speech brings two kinds of retribution. What? One, everyone accepts what you say, and two, your words are clearly understood. Even to the point where you just kind of nod towards it and people go, right, what he said, right? Never did I have that experience. My words were weightless. They were like popcorn. You eat it, you're still hungry. Right? Does popcorn satisfy your hunger? No. My words were like popcorn.
I noticed that when I speak frivolously, it's because I have like so much energy that everything just spew out, even thoughtless nonsense ones. And so how should I, like, you know, turn that around?
Samadhi. More samadhi.
Okay.
It comes over time, I think. And if you have more samadhi, what is it? It's not so much that your words are good or right or smart, it's you speak like a doctor, which is what this is the best thing to say given that situation, right? So that only comes with really tuning into the person you're talking to. If you're really tuned into the person you're talking to and you're hearing them, then you don't need a lot of words. You will communicate. the value which I learned, I mean, that's my suggestion, Connie. I don't know if that's true for you, but the deal is, if you're talking to somebody, and you wouldn't be talking to yourself, right? If you're talking to somebody, it's a conversation, and half or more of the time that you are speaking should be listening. So you know what they're thinking. You know what they're, where they hurt. So if I can speak for bodhisattvas in the sutra, they use their words to help heal pain. They're like a really good doctor. Every word counts because that's what works, you know. Now, bodhisattvas always speak, you know, kind of like out of the heavens. No, they talk normal. Haha, they tell a lot. You can tell jokes, but it's not meant to make you like me, right? If it's a funny joke, yeah, you want to tell it. Tell it well. Tell stories. But the stories are not meant to increase your desire to get near me, which is what earlier, that was pretty much all I had in mind, right? Does that make sense? You follow? Yeah. Sandy? You had your hand up.
Well, I don't know if this is going to work for you or not, Connie, but have you attempted the exercise of poetry, like haiku, say more with less?
Yeah, haiku, 17 syllables.
Say
you got
more
17
with
syllables.
Less and the timing of it.
Right.
Know, and you have to think and process.
Right.
So it might be more fun for you this way.
Yeah, good. So there we go. Okay, you know what? Our time's up. It didn't last long, did it? I had an amazing experience just minutes before coming down to start the sutra tonight, which is I was upstairs and I heard a roar. And I went, tick, tick, oh, football today. I heard, does anybody know what Memorial Stadium seating is? Is it 40,000? Maybe? Does the UC Berkeley football stadium? Nobody? Texas. So how many bodies can fit in Memorial Stadium? I haven't been for a while. I think 40, right? 40,000 maybe? Is that right? Probably full today. I just heard the voice of 40,000 people coming down Bancroft all the way to Berkeley Monastery. That was an awesome sound. The voice of 40,000. Somebody scored, probably, you know, either that or a pass was intercepted or something. But there were 40,000 people going, and I heard it down here. It's Saturday night's kind of quiet, you know, traffic's down. But that was an awesome sound of 40,000 people being moved all at once. Oh my. That's another kind of communication. You know, volume. Now, Marty, it's very funny. We're back into our regular autumn class schedule, and Professor Verhoeven is sitting here, actually down there, on Friday nights. And what is going on? Berkeley High football! We're into September, right? So that stadium is one block away. You can see the lights from where we're sitting right here. That's another sound. That's like 2,000, you know. And the announcers are score, penalty, morning, flag, and fourth play. You know, and then, but this was that number times 20 from almost a mile away. Sound of 40,000 people cheering traveled a mile to come. Amazing. So interesting, huh? 60,000, thank you. So, boy, we're into autumn, and one of the signs of autumn is large numbers of people coming together to celebrate score! By golly. Okay, I need to pick up a guitar here. We're going to do the transference of merit because not everybody, some folks, believe it or not, Jerry, how many folks are online right now? 34 people. Oh, no, we have more in person. That's a good sign. Some people are tuning in from a distance, and they're not necessarily interested in what in the last half hour. So if we transfer early, then they can sign off if they're listening from other parts of the globe. So we'll do the dedication first, and then finish our story section and our announcements. So this is the dedication, and there we go. I knew that was. Aha. Let me run through. It's when you have 12, it takes. Here we go. Okay. Dedication of Merit is there on the back of your songbook. And we do it with a wish that you bring forth. That's a very wholesome, that's not a mental defilement. Unless you make it one. I guess you could transfer negatively, I suppose. But may all beings drop dead, you know. Or just Stanford students, I don't know. University of Texas defenders, you know. Nah, we wouldn't do that. Erase that. Run the tape back, scratch that. I didn't say that. Oh, false speech. So, make a wish, and let's do this. Wow, without a microphone, this guitar is so loud. Whew, loud. Pregnant pause on that G chord before we resolve back to the C. Here we go. May every living being, our minds as one and radiant with light, share the fruits of peace with hearts of goodness, luminous and bright. If people hear and see, our hands and hearts can find in giving unity. May our minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness find reward. May all who sorrow leave their grief and pain. May this boundless light break the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate and wise. All right. Now, I wanted to share something that is new and special, which is in telling stories, there's lots and lots of stories that come through the Buddha Dharma. And one of the stories that we tell here in this, our version of the Buddha Dharma, is stories from China and things that people may not necessarily think of as stories, but indeed they are. And one of my favorite stories that Shifu, that Master Hua, introduced to us is a story attributed to Confucius, a Confucian story. And I'm going to tell it with the help of this Regal resonator guitar, made in China, by the way, and very sweet. Called a great commonwealth of peace and prosperity. Now, what is it about this story? It's that this is a world where things go right. And I was thinking one of the best stories these days would be telling about humanity's potential to do things differently. And the second ground is about, or the 10 grounds is about thoughts. Thoughts that are so automatic they become wu gong yong, right? They become effortless thoughts. So in this great commonwealth of peace and prosperity, Confucius, whether he said it or not, but we attribute it to Confucius, he was a contemporary of the Buddha. Confucius said, here's the world we want. When things go right, here's the world we want. Let me read it to you. In Taiwan, I know, I don't know about China anymore, but in Taiwan, you sing it. This is one of the things that people did, right? 金佛师那个孔子里云大通篇，大家都会唱了, right? 国小, right? Was that, did you learn how to sing this when you were in elementary school?
会不会?不记得,太老了。 不会，我听说国小、国中都会唱这个孔子礼云大通篇。没有了哈。huh?
Anybody know? Was it? Did you? Can you still do it? You still remember? I'm not going to test you. That's right. So, it was one of the. Alan, did you learn how to do it?
Maybe. Okay.
Yeah, that's grade school. Are you kidding me? Grade school. So, it was something that grade school kids would sing. And it was the beautiful world, right? So there's a melody and all. Now, it goes like this. When the great spiritual path, Da Dao, when the Dao is enacted in the world, if the Dao took form and shape and started to motivate us, what would it be like? Everything is public. Da Dao, Zhi Xing Ye, Tian Xia Wei Gong. Everything is public. There's no private. The virtuous and the able are chosen for public office. Don't even bring his name up. Virtuous, able are chosen for public office. Integrity and friendliness are valued by all. People cherish not only their own parents, but and parents and children, but they cherish the parents and children of others as their own. Imagine. The elderly live their last years in happiness. Able-bodied adults are usefully employed. Children are properly reared, not left to raise themselves, or worse, given a cell phone or an iPad to raise, or a TV or a video game to raise them. Widowers, widows, orphans, and the childless aged, the crippled and the ailing are all well cared for. All men share their social responsibilities. All women have their respective roles. Notice, that's not gender language. I mean, it's not There's no description there. It's respective roles. This one breaks my heart. Natural resources are fully used for the benefit of all and not wasted or appropriated for selfish ends. Oil? BP doesn't own the oil under the Gulf. Who says? Right? People want to contribute their strength and ability to society for the public good and not for private gains. The profit motive. I mean, this sounds communist. No, it's not communist. It's humane. It's not owned by communists or capitalists. This is the payoff, right? Trickery and cheating could not occur in such a society. Robbery, banditry, rebellions, and other crimes all disappear. Gates and doors are not locked. No one ever thinks of stealing. This is the age of the great commonwealth of peace and prosperity. Imagine, you know. And somebody's going to go, oh, you're so naive, you know. Wait a minute. Confucius, same time as the Buddha, same time as Plato, was looking at human nature before we got so twisted. When the great spiritual path, the Tao, is practiced, everything is public. The virtuous and the able are chosen for public office. Integrity and friendliness are valued by all. People cherish not only their own parents and children, but cherish the children and parents of others as well. The elderly live their last years in happiness. Able-bodied adults are usefully employed. Children are properly reared. Widowers, widows, orphans, and the childless aged. The crippled and the ailing are all well cared for. All men have their social responsibilities. All women have their respective roles. Natural resources are fully used for the benefit of all, not wasted or appropriated for selfish ends. People want to contribute their strength and ability to society for the public good. Trickery and cheating could not occur in such a society. robbery, banditry, rebellions, and other crimes all disappear. Gates and doors are not locked. No one ever thinks of stealing. This is the age of the great commonwealth of peace and prosperity. So, why not? Well, but that's an American Dharma master. I know. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of green. Why not? I think the Buddha would say greed, anger, delusion, pride and doubt, affliction. But education should be about waking us up to the poisons inside and the virtues. So, anyhow, that's a great story, the great commonwealth of peace and prosperity. They say it's a Confucian document. Why not? Give it to Confucius. The Chinese have said so for a long time, so we'll take it. Anyway, that story needs to be told more often. Yeah? Okay. Shoot. Do the 10 grounds become one? The 10 grounds are just tools. To say 10 tools become one tool, nah. They're 10. And if they were one, then all of this lecturing would have been useless, right? Or just lecture once and you would have gotten it. 10 are 10. However, the tools are used to make one result, which is an end to suffering. So you could say the 10 grounds result in one, if they're hammers and saws and chisels and, you know, planes and paint, you're trying to make the mansion of Bodhi. You're trying to make a house of awakening for that holds everybody. So the result of the 10 grounds is one. But the 10 grounds themselves are 10. Right? I mean, you could explain it all as one, I suppose, but that's just forcing it. So. Okay? All right. Let's see. We have a week of events coming up. Check berkeleymonastery.org. For the schedule, the weekly schedule. And also, tomorrow, the Neighborhood Earthquake Preparedness Group is going to meet in our dining room, or in the Buddha Hall or in the dining room. It is the Nuns Sharing Dharma. Every month we invite the nuns from not Aloka. Is there Aloka Vihara? Aloka Vihara to come. They have a new home up in the Sierras, foothills. And they come down and speak in our urban center here. So those two events are happening at the same time. The earthquake preparedness group of our neighborhood, which has been meeting for decades, coming and going as people come and go. But some good-hearted folks started the initiative anew, and we're going to host the neighborhood gathering. And it comes down to very practical things, such as, do you know where your gas shutoff valve is. And if you don't, good thing to know. Ours, you go out the front door, go down the sidewalk, right to the driveway that goes up past the bamboo there, and on the edge, on the southeastern edge of our building is the gas meter. And the gas meter has a funny, flat, narrow, slide rule-looking wrench thing that you put on and you go crank, and it turns the gas flow off to the building. And most of the problems in earthquakes is not the shaking, it's the fire that follows the shaking, because people's gas lines get ruptured. And the shaking is one, but the burning is another. And if you know where in your building, you might tomorrow when the sun's up, go find out. Did everybody, and our wrench is like chained on to the meter so that it doesn't leave the meter, so you can go pong, and you can turn the gas off within a second or two. And then, even though there's a spark, the gas is not flowing, you know, out. So you think, oh, that's great, we're safe. What about next door neighbor? His house catches fire because she didn't know where the gas turnoff was. So neighborhood preparedness is making sure you know, and the neighbor, and the neighbor, and the neighbor. Turn off the gas. Big deal. Also, there's all kinds of knowledge that's helpful in times of earthquake. You know, our local neighborhood gathering before earthquake preparedness group broke down into communications group. That was the one I was on, staying in touch with shortwave radio and citizens band to what the government is saying, what the police and fire are saying. There's the pet division, taking care of the animals that are panicked, terrified, and need care. And the medical division, learning how to set broken bones and stop bleeding. The fire suppression, right? The food and water. The children division, taking care of terrified kids. The fire, how to hook up a fire hose to the local, you know.
I have training for that.
Training for, yeah. There you go, yeah. In Berkeley, I don't know about where you all come from, communities around the Bay Area, there's something called a CERT, C-E-R, Certified Training, Certified Emergency Rescue Training, I think. And it happens at the firehouse. And the firemen and women are just hoping that citizens will come and get trained in those basic things. And they tell you what to stockpile, how much water, you know, usually 3 or 4 days worth. You need to be independent for 3 or 4 days until rescue can come in. So all that stuff is available here in Berkeley. I'm not sure about your community, but my guess is, you bet, they've got it. Or if there isn't, you should ask for it. Say, could you train me in over a weekend on what I need to know to take care of myself and my neighbor? You know, that's really wholesome, because we're at risk here, you know. So tomorrow is our latest incarnation of that earthquake preparedness group. And that's a wholesome thing. So if anybody is interested, you don't have to be from our neighborhood to come to the meeting. That's also, you know, you'll see all the neighbors. And our downtown McGee, what do we call it? We're the McGee neighborhood. Forget. McGee? Yeah. How do you spell? Spalding McGee. SP. Those are the original settlers in our part of downtown. This group is one of the earliest ones to really take it seriously, and go out and ask for, you know, get it together. And the knowledge is knowledge. So come tomorrow. What time are we meeting? 4 o'clock. 4 to 5. And, you know, maybe you can go back to your neighborhood and start it up. So anyway, it's a good thing. What other announcements?
There's actually an event that would be good to let everyone know about in UC Berkeley, also co-sponsored by Dharma Realm Buddhist University. There's actually a very well-known and erudite scholar of the Vedas who has come and been staying the last month in a city of 10,000 Buddhas. And they're going to be having a conference in honor of him at UC Berkeley on parts of the Vedas. And so Dharma Realm Buddhist University is co-sponsoring it. Lauren Bausch, who's the professor, she made the associate professor there, is also helping to organize it. So if people are interested, you can find the link on the drbu.org website. drbu.org. He recently gave a talk at 10,000 Buddhas. The very nice, older Indian gentleman has a lot of knowledge.
This is one of the world's experts on the Vedas, which some people would say are the oldest living literature, mm-hmm. predating Buddhist sutras. And he's in Sanskrit. So. Yeah. Professor T-H-I-T-E, Taiti, right? Tite. Tite. Yeah, Professor Tite. He's an old timer and really knows the stuff. And it's at Cal and when?
Cal.
Not at Stanford? Oh, it's at Cal. Oh, okay. Yeah. And when?
It's on the, not this weekend, but it's Sunday. It's Sunday.
That's tomorrow.
September 25th. 25th. So you have a week to prepare. So if people are interested, if you go to drbu.org, there's a link there. I'm sure if you just type that into Google search, Veda conference at UC Berkeley, you'll probably find that.
They would be thrilled if you'd come, I'm sure. Southeast Asian Studies group at Cal, and they invited him, and he lectured at CTTB and stayed there. So. Great. Okay, any more? Meowa. Not. All right. So as Srifa would say, if it's the Tao, advance. If it's not the Tao, retreat. Pick out what's good from the things you've heard and follow them, and pick out what's not so good and change it in yourself first and then in the world. See you next week. Oh, by the way, next week is the third ground we're going to review, and it's psychic powers, Shantong power, next week. Bow in respect to the Venerable Master. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo.